in the nation.
ZFM Stereo.
It's Lionel Messi. He scored. The goal the world wanted.
It's time for the biggest sports stories.
It's Neymar trying to feed it through. It's a stretch and it's in. And I can't remember the last time I saw something like this. Extraordinary scenes.
The biggest interviews.
It's more difficult. Obviously, it's more difficult.
And all the analysis right here.
If they play poorly, they come back, they've got all the excuses. You can't have it both ways.
Every weekday, it's my sport, it's your sport. It's CFM Sport. Let's join the team for the biggest show in the world of sport on CFM Stereo. My station, your station.
Here on ZFM Sport, this and every single weekday, we come at you in different angles. Today, we got a new angle because we are focusing on the administration of sport. You look at the Zimbabwe Olympic Committee and indeed the International Olympic Committee. We're looking at British athletics and athletics in general. We're also looking at Formula One and some changes that they are making. Administration of sport is also covered right here on ZFM Sport because we just love sport. And those who love sport are Mike Madoda, Mark Pozzo, Chris Gray, me, Barry Malandi, Alois Bunjira, and our producer, the dearest Sean Tafirenyika.
We always start on the home front in cricket news. After going down by 5 wickets to Afghanistan in the first T20, the Chevrons have a chance to make amends in the second T20 in Sharjah. And I can tell you that Afghanistan have batted first and they're currently 114-3. Moving on to organised games, Zimbabwean Olympics swimmer Kirsty Coventry was officially appointed by the IOC president as the commission's chair during a joint meeting between the IOC Executive Board and Athletes Commission in South Korea yesterday. And we wrap it up with football news where Hau Mine have been hit by a player exodus, forcing the club to revise its strategy and rebuild a team using so-called unknowns to compete in the 2018 Castle Lager Premier Soccer League season.
In your international sports news roundup in athletics, British Athletics announced the creation of Athletics World Cup event featuring 8 top nations, which will take place at the London Stadium on the 14th and 15th of July. In Formula One, Formula One has announced Grid Kids will be used this season after the sport controversially abolished its long-standing association with the Grid Girls. And in tennis, world number one Rafael Nadal expects to be back in playing competitive tennis by the end of the month.
To the beautiful game, went to the Premier League, where Antonio Conte says he's not concerned about his future despite Chelsea's recent form putting his position under considerable pressure. To La Liga, a FIFA delegation led by Secretary General Fatma Samoura met with Spanish officials to discuss concerns about government meddling in the local football federation. And to the Serie A, where former Inter Milan president Massimo Moratti says he, like many of the club's fans, feels like he's been fooled by the Nazzurri's form this season.
The Warriors, the Chevrons, the Cheetahs, the Mighty Warriors, and the Sables. From the pool to the track to the field, we are Team Zimbabwe. The home front. Local sports news and analysis.
Zimbabwe certainly very active on the cricket field. But before we get to that story of the series versus Afghanistan, the T20 series, just to remind you of our WhatsApp platform. The number there is 0731-168-045. Cricket fans, now is your chance to have your say, your way on the show. That's for the fans. That number again, 0731-168-045. We're also on Twitter and Facebook at ZFM Sport. Now, after going down by 5 wickets to Afghanistan in the first T20, the Chevrons have a chance to make amends in the second T20 in Sharjah. Mohammed Nabi's 27-ball 40 made quick work of the 121 target set by Zimbabwe, helping Afghanistan take a 1-0 lead in the two-match T20 international series. 5 Afghanistan bowlers were among the wickets, with leg spinner Rashid Khan collecting 3 as Zimbabwe fell away after a rollicking start in the power play to end their 20 overs with a below par total. Despite the humid conditions, Afghanistan's batsmen were not made to break a sweat. The chase was completed with a massive 32 balls to spare. Just a recap of what happened yesterday: Zimbabwe 120 for 9 meter with 34, Rashid 3 for 19. In reply, Afghanistan, Atakanta, 121 for 5. Nabi, 40 not out. Muzaramadi, the pick of our bowlers, 2 for 36. Afghanistan winning by 5 wickets. They are in action again today. And we can tell you that Afghanistan are batting. And they're currently 131 for 3 after 16.3 overs. Mohammad Shahzad, 17 at the top of the order. Karim Sadiq, 28. And then some destructive batting from Asghar Staniskai, their captain, 27, just off 14 ball strike rate, 192. Mohammad Nabi, he's currently not out, 29 off 20 ball strike rate, 145. And also not out at the moment, Najibullah Zadran, 22 from 15 balls. So they look like they're cracking on now, trying to get a decent total, maybe 160, 170. Afghanistan and Zimbabwe, Mark, will have it all to do.
They certainly are going to have it all to do. Current run rate just over 8.1. So as you say, if they get to 170, 180, it's game on. And I'm afraid to say I back Afghanistan, yeah?
No, it's more game over, I think, more than game on.
Yeah,
because
yeah, exactly.
in truth, I don't think the Chevrons will be able to successfully chase that down on the basis that you can expect that run rate is going to go up in these last sort of five overs that they're already into. So I expect that Afghanistan, jeesh, is going to be a big total.
And it was the same problem, wasn't it, Mark? Our middle order failing to deliver last night, and that's why we ended up with that subpar total.
Yeah, our middle order failing to deliver, and then you go into this game and it looks like our bowlers are failing to do the business, because they've used six bowlers and they've gone for a lot of runs. I mean, if you just have a look at Mazara Bani, 3 overs, 1 for 32, economy rate of just over 10.6. Sikinder Raza, 2 overs, none for 26. He was expensive. That's 13 runs and over. And then basically 10.5 runs and over, 10.6 runs and over. The most consistent so far has been Tendai Chitara. In fact, Graham Creamer, he's bowled his 4 overs, 2 for 20. So he's done his job, but he really hasn't had any support.
Yeah, no support at all. And just taking a look at the situation that Zimbabwe finds itself in, using these games to prepare for the World Cup qualifiers. Barry, I know this is T20 international cricket, very different from the 50-over game. But in terms of just giving you confidence or taking away from your confidence, Zimbabwe has got to be worried, especially cricket fans. They'll be looking at this, at Zimbabwe's performances over the last 3 or so weeks, and thinking, hang on, we might be in a bit of trouble when the World Cup qualifiers swing around.
We haven't toured well. We haven't been playing well. And as you say, it's a confidence game. And you want to get a few victories under your belt. You want to get your eye in, as it were, before you get into the qualifiers. And we haven't been able to do that.
You should be beating teams like this.
It should be a routine victory against Afghanistan.
Correct. To be fair, Afghanistan has come on a bit. And the thing is that we haven't stood still. Had we stood still, we'd probably be more competitive. We've gone backwards. And we've got to then take note of that. And I don't think that anyone at Zimbabwe Cricket is actually looking at it in that fashion, that we've regressed.
I think they're just happy to be playing cricket. And Marv Salt has got in touch on Twitter. He says, great show, guys. I'm tuned in. And he says, LOL Barry and his new songs, though. Ha, ha, ha. I'm not quite sure he enjoys the new songs. But there have been a lot of messages that have been coming in on Twitter regards the performance of the Zimbabwe cricket team, whether they are good enough or whether they just don't cut it at international level. And it's a debate, unfortunately, Mark, that always keeps coming up, because fans are sort of like disappointed. At one time, we look like we are going somewhere, and then the next match or the next series swings around, and then we look like we are going nowhere. Because after we beat Sri Lanka last year, there was a lot of hope, a lot of optimism that Zimbabwe could kick on.
Yeah, I think you've been a little bit kind. You know what? We're good today and we're bad tomorrow. And that is a reality where we're facing. We're not going by series. We're actually going by game at the moment.
Yeah.
And it's very sad, because as you say, we've gone backwards, and a team like Afghanistan have gone forward.
Yeah.
And are playing very, very good cricket. I mean, their spinner Khan has actually signed to play for I think Sussex in the county league. And
county league,
of course,
right.
He was just part of the side, the Strikers, I think it were, who won the Big Bash in Australia. And he played a significant part, one of the leading wicket takers in the tournament.
Yeah, there you go. So you've got those sort of performances, and those contribute to the team effort. Zimbabwe cricket needs to come out and say, this is our plan, guys. This is how we're changing things, because we keep putting a team together, and that team is not good enough.
Good evening to Mubao on Twitter. He says, as for me, I always say if cricket was my job and I performed like this every day, surely I would have been fired years ago.
There you go.
And exactly. He says, and then we've got another tweet that's coming in from Vorky, the village storyteller. I like that. He says, Zimbabwe cricket needs to stop making excuses for a team that is constantly slipping. And he says, imagine performing like that with such consistency and still getting paid thousands. Silly Midoff also weighs in and says, it's time for performance-based contracts to be put into play. I'm not worried about our bowling. We are targeting criminals around them. Our bowling is actually decent. Taking five, defending 120 is commendable. So there's someone who saw a positive from yesterday's performance where we were able to take five wickets in the chase of about 120 that Afghanistan needed. 121 it was, and we were able to take five wickets. So he's commending the bowlers, but saying that the batting is just not up to scratch.
100%. And listen, taking the five wickets is great, but also you got to think to yourself, Afghanistan would have gone in and batted with abandon. So perhaps they weren't as cautious as they could have been. Parker on our WhatsApp platform said, Afghanistan is far better than us. We need another wrist spinner to partner Creamer like Chahal and Yadav do for India. This one said, the problem with Zim cricket is on player selection. We keep rotating the same non-performing players. If some do not perform, they must be dropped, especially Irvin. The other thing is players are playing all formats, and that is wrong. That's Matthew Batsi in Chinoy.
You see, my biggest disappointment, Mike, is that, you see, like the listener just said, that we keep on rotating players. But do we have the other players? We don't have backup. We don't have players that are coming through. Our junior development structure is in shambles. So that's the saddest part. Those are the guys that we have. When you look back, you try to look where, when we drop them, who do we pick and put them there? You start finding it very difficult. So that is actually the way we see us in the mud. We don't have prospects at all.
Do we guys then take a gamble on Joao at this stage? Because the batting is failing.
Nothing to lose.
Exactly.
Nothing to lose.
That's the answer.
He's performing at franchise level.
Yep. Yep.
Do we take a chance on him, Mark? Do we throw him in the fray? Because he can't do any worse than the fellas that are being picked right now.
Exactly. Throw him in. This is where you should be. You know what? He's performing. Let's see what he can do.
Mike, you know my philosophy.
Yeah.
My philosophy is, if things are going badly, try things.
Yeah.
Show us that you're doing something to try and fix it. Even if it goes horribly wrong, you know, we'll forgive you because at least you tried something. Not to keep picking the same guys and hoping for a different result.
Okay, keep your messages coming in. Remember our WhatsApp number 0731 168 0045, and Twitter and Facebook at ZFM Sport. And just a parting shot from Larry Trucida. He says, we can say all we want, but the truth of the matter is we just are not talented enough. How many Zimbabwe players would make it into the current Bangladesh team?
Hi, I'm Kirsty Coventry, and you're listening to ZFM Sport.
Going on with our local sports news roundup, and let's talk about Kirsty Coventry, because Zimbabwe Olympic swimmer Kirsty Coventry was officially appointed by the IOC president as the commission's chair during a joint meeting between the IOC executive board and Athletes Commission in South Korea yesterday. Coventry has been a member of the IOC Athletes Commission since 2012 and had a significant role in developing the commission's new strategy, which was presented at the International Athletes Forum last November. Two athletics and Harare-based middle and long-distance runner Munyaradzi Jari says he's eager to make the cut for the 2019 IAAF World Championships when he competes in his first marathon in Nigeria. Jari is set to depart for the West African country tomorrow, where he will take part in the Lagos City Marathon on Saturday. Jari has also one goal, to run a qualifying time for the global meet to be staged in Qatar next year. And to football, where Haumein have been hit by a player exodus, forcing the club to revise its strategy and rebuild a team by using so-called unknowns to compete in the 2018 Castle Lager Premier Soccer League. Financial challenges hit the gold miners last season and saw players striking over outstanding salaries, bonuses and signing on fees. This in turn forced senior players to look for greener pastures.
Here we go again. Enjoy world-class radio online. ZFM Stereo is available on TuneIn. Search for ZFM Stereo and you got it. News, lifestyle, charts, live radio, station highlights, and much more. Get it all on zfmstereo.co.zw.
From the front of the grid to the back of the net, it's ZFM Sport. International Sports News Roundup, where the world comes out to play.
All right, the new Athletics World Cup has been hailed as, quote, a magic bullet for the
sport.
Silver
bullet.
A silver bullet, indeed, for the sport following its launch. The British Athletics announced the creation of a brand new eight-nation competition, and the inaugural edition will be held at the London Stadium, scheduled for the weekend of the 2018 FIFA World Cup final and Tennis Wimbledon finals on the evenings of July the 14th and 15th. It'll be contested by Great Britain, the United States, Jamaica, South Africa, China, Germany, France and Poland. UK Athletics Chief Executive Niels de Vos billed the event as all the best bits of the World Championships rolled into two sessions. He added, in terms of traditional athletics, I think this is a fantastic idea, and it's fantastic because it is so simple. I like the idea. The timing is hardly ideal, surely.
Yeah, it's hardly ideal. But for me, I'm also concerned. The idea is great. But where are some of the traditional athletics, heavyweights like Kenya and Ethiopia? Yeah, you know, they've cut out some of the most exciting events in athletics, which is the 5,000 and 10,000 meters and the steeplechase, which are sort of like events where a lot of the African countries, like Kenya and Ethiopia,
would feature.
And that, for me, is the disappointing aspect. And you can see why they've gone for South Africa. They've gone for South Africa because South Africa currently has got a couple of world champions in the long jump, as well as the Wade Vanika Kaposa, who's in the sprints, the 400 and 200 meters. Mm. And that's why they've gone for South Africa. Otherwise, this thing will probably not even have the participation of an African country.
Yeah, exactly. And, well, listen, they've given the explanation that they don't want the long distance events because of time constraints. But if you're talking about time, number one, then you're talking about TV. And if you're talking about TV viewership, surely you don't want to compete with the World Cup final and Wimbledon.
But you guys, you've got to admit that some of the most exciting events when you watch athletics are actually the 5,000, the middle and the long distances are actually some of the most exciting. Why? Because it's actually an event. The 100 meters happens over 9 to 10 seconds. It's gone. It's done.
That's what I wanted to say, Mike. If you look at it, it's 100 meters, 200, it's explosive, and you're just like, it's out. But when it's like 5,000 meters, you actually go there competing when the one is overtaking.
Competition.
And you can watch that one. Yeah, watch that one coming. You know, it's actually more exciting. I don't understand this.
Yeah, the reasoning I don't understand.
The reasoning, I don't understand.
These are decisions made by men in suits.
Right.
And I don't think they actually did any survey.
Who never
asked fans to say, fans, would you mind having the 5,000 meters? Listen, they could have said, maybe not 10,000 meters. We'll have the 5,000 meters.
Yeah, exactly.
We'll have the 3,000 meters.
3,500.
We'll have the 3,000 meters steeplechase. Yeah. Things like that.
Yeah.
If they'd asked the fans wouldn't have been complaining. I can bet you that.
Yeah, and look, in truth, I think this is the first one. And I suspect that it'll be in a very different format when it comes to rolls round. If it rolls round next year, because I think they want to fit in those middle and longer distances. Also because I think the spread of nations is going to make it seem more like a World Cup.
We are CFM Stereo. Hot, 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 hot. Around the world in 60 seconds. International sports news.
We begin with news coming out of the US. Formula One has announced Grid Kids will be used this season after the sport controversially abolished its long-standing association with Grid Girls. Formula One American owners Liberty Media denounced the long-standing practice of using female models before Grand Prix is at odds with modern-day societal norms. This is much to the dismay of male chauvinists across the world who are enjoying the
and
view.
In the studio.
Across to Mexico, world number one Rafael Nadal expects to be back playing competitive tennis by the end of the month. Nadal will most likely return to action at Acapulco on the 26th of February. In England, though, scrum half Ben Youngs has been ruled out for the rest of England's Six Nations campaign and faces 4 months on the sidelines, and this is after rupturing ligaments in his left knee. England successfully began their bid for a record third straight outright Six Nations title with a 46-15 win over Italy in Rome on Sunday. The talented scrum half was lost to injury less than 10 minutes into the game. We touched down in South Korea, where 32 Russian athletes have appealed against their exclusion from this month's Winter Olympics. They include those who had their life bans lifted by the Court of Arbitration for Sport last week. A hearing is set to take place tomorrow, 2 days before the games.
Connect with CFM Stereo via Facebook on facebook.com/CFM Stereo.
Fan Zone. Get in touch with the team and have your say your way.
Operator.
Get in touch with us on 0731-168-045. That's 0731-168-05. And I chuckle because Peter sent us a message. And Peter says, Formula One. And he's very disappointed. He sent emojis. And he says, now they've removed the one reason Hyundai won a Formula One.
Just like I said
it yesterday.
I never watched ladies tennis all of last season. What Serena stops?
Yeah, what's the point?
Exactly. I mean?
No Serena, no tennis.
Doesn't mean you had a chauvinist.
I think people have got different motivations as to why watch the Y Sport. I remember this one time, World Cup. I think it was the World Cup in 2014, I think.
Yeah.
2014 World. Was it 24? No. 2014. Yes, 2014 World Cup. And I remember my little sister at varsity then, and she was like, you know what? I like the Spain team because it's got lots of cute guys.
Yeah, here we go. Exactly.
She would watch Spain simply because said they had cute guys, not for the football. Now, do we say that that's being sexist, that she's just judging men by
objectifying
men?
No.
How come it's cute, Chris, when it's women?
Who are saying men are cute?
Yes.
Right. Have you faced centuries of chauvinism, objectification, and sexism, and opportunities denied to you?
No, you see, women
because of your gender.
You don't understand.
No, that's exactly what it is. It's historical oppression.
Can I tell you something? When I say Chris, you are stunning, my love, and you've got quite you've got quite a rack on you. That is an endearment.
No.
Now, you think I'm being sexual.
We work together, so that is called sexual harassment.
I'm complimenting you.
No. Yes, that's exactly what it is.
No.
Listen.
A compliment.
Wow, a group of men cannot. No.
I'm willing to go to court and say to them, Your Honor, have a look at her. Doesn't she have a rack on her?
The judge will probably be a man.
Maybe you don't want to come to work on this particular day, but then you think, hey, Chris,
as a man, you cannot tell women what they should and should not be comfortable with and how they should take things. I feel that you are
similarly as women, don't deny us the presence of women who want to be there.
Gentlemen, I have a message
I'm disappointed
illustrates the point. It's from Arthur.
Okay,
very insightful. Arthur says, it's ironic that Formula One have fired hardworking women to empower women.
There we go.
They've disempowered women.
And do you know?
Employment. Those ladies were earning a lot of money. They've lost jobs.
The biggest critics of women, sadly, are women.
Are women. Mm-hmm. They fought very hard to make other women lose their jobs. they fought so hard to make the other women lose their jobs.
And there we are. Anyway, let's go to cricket. Jaquilo says, Brendan Taylor's performance hasn't been convincing and still owes that big return. It's like he never left. So I think he's still got that big innings that we were all looking forward to. It hasn't happened.
Mark, what have you made of the performances of Brendan Taylor and Kyle Jarvis since their return? Have they given us the impetus that we were looking forward to? Have they performed as well as you thought that they might?
No. I certainly would have thought they would have performed a whole heap better. But you know what? I think they are both very, very talented cricketers. And let's just hope that something happens. I can just quickly breaking into that. 158-49 is the latest. So maybe they were listening to us. Because some quick fire wickets there. Three for Chitara, 3 for 20, 2 for 48 for Mazarabani, 2 for 20 for Creamer, and 2 for 22 for Kyle Jarvis from his 4. So they have picked up their socks a little bit and kept that run rate to below 8 at this stage. So the target is 150. 159.
Okay, and Barry, I wanted to ask you that. Sure. That we were previously talking about maybe 170, and that proves that nothing stops the run rate quite like taking wickets.
Like taking wickets, exactly, because what you're getting is that, and better still, if you get the wicket of the set batsman, then what you're getting is fresh batsman coming in, and if you are putting the ball in the right areas, you're able to then continue taking
those
wickets.
But what else does it tell us? It tells us, you know what, we are capable of doing it.
Yes,
and it's
exactly,
frustrating.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a consistency, isn't it? Chisawira in Kwekwe says this: Alois, I beg to differ with you. We have talent, but the selectors are the problem. When did Masakadze start playing for the national team? Yes, he has played his part. Take those schoolboys playing in those schools. Let them play the T20 format. No matter the result, from there we will see the talent. That's what we're talking about, saying, let's try things, guys.
I think you picked a bad example.
A bad example, yeah, agreed. Yeah. The principle, we agree with the principle, Chisawira, but obviously a bad example, yeah.
Yeah, like, yes, what I'm saying is, he's right. We need to try these youngsters. But my argument was, do we have those talented? Who? Pick us. Give us. Who and who? Five. Who you think can be thrown in there to actually do the job?
And also,
it's now a try and error thing.
And also, we have seen how well our national team cricketers perform in domestic competition. They perform very well. And that shows me that the talent that we are producing, that we're feeding into our franchise system, is not quite good enough.
That's
because
what I'm saying.
If these guys are able to dominate,
to go back there and dominate these youngsters,
then it shows you that those youngsters may not quite be ready. What we need to look at is the system and say, is our system producing good enough cricketers?
Yes.
And that's the issue, whereby we are relying on the schools to produce the system, wherein also Zimbabwe cricket has no tentacles, has no hand in producing the talent. So
that's,
we're just hoping that something's coming out.
Sangsi has got in touch and he's a regular listener to the show. Good evening to you. He says, he's asking actually, who appraises the Chevrons? Because seriously, they're just content on playing and they lack ambition.
Yeah, that listen, the thing is, it might be a communication issue. I would be very concerned if Zimbabwe cricket just looks at these results and thinks, well, you know, let's go on to the next one. We go again. And don't make any sort of assessments. What we aren't sure of is who that assessment panel is and what they're saying.
But even if they do have the assessments, Barry, do they have the strategies
to change things?
To change things.
No, clearly
not. Because for me, as long as they're playing cricket, you might actually be surprised. You think that, oh no, they may not be content with play. They may actually be content from a commercial perspective.
Yeah, as long as
they are playing, they're getting money.
They're getting TV money,
and they're getting money from the ICC. So commercially, they might be saying, okay, as a business unit, we're doing well. We are managing the sport well. And that might be the way they're looking at it. Marv Salter has got in touch again and he says, Zimbabwe cricket is in trouble. We've got to do better. Let's hope we're actually able to win this evening's
game. There's another cry from the wilderness here. You don't give us your name. Please send your name when you send in your messages. This one says, why are they leaving out Joao out of the Chevron squad?
No,
well, we don't know.
We don't have any answers.
To all you Twitter heads, connect with CFM Stereo on twitter.com/CFM Stereo.
Hi, my name is Leighty Tembwe. You're listening to CFM Sports.
The big leagues, the big teams, the big players. The beautiful game on CFM Sport.
Right, no better place for us to start the beautiful game coverage than in England, where Antonio Conte says he is not concerned about his future despite Chelsea's recent form putting his position under considerable pressure. Conte was in defiant mood after seeing the pressure mount on his position with a 4-1 defeat to Watford last night. There have been reports Conte could be sacked if Chelsea's below par start to the year continues. More questions are likely to be asked after a slack display at Vicarage Road with Timoue Bakayoko dismissed after 30 minutes and Watford scoring 3 late goals to secure a resounding win. Chelsea head coach Antonio Conte says he is not worried about his losing his job after the 4-1 defeat to Watford.
Very difficult for me to transfer my thought, no? And I hope that tonight, for once, you understand me. I'm not worried. I'm not worried about my job. I work every day and I give 120%, okay? If this is enough, it's okay. Otherwise, the club can take a different decision, but I'm not worried. But It's very difficult because every day, every press conference you ask me, are you worried about your job? No, I'm not worried. Tomorrow is another day. I can be the Chelsea coach or not. Which is the problem? My soul, is clear, and I repeat, I go to sleep without the problem that maybe I could do this. No, I try to do everything. If this is enough, it's okay. Otherwise, the club to take another decision. But I think that the problem is for you, not is for me or for the club. Then, if this problem become of the club, it's okay. Oh.
That is one of the most defiant interviews I've heard in a long time. And he belabored the point, but I think he needed to say that he's not worried. But surely he's got to be worried about something. That something being the form of Chelsea Football Club, because they're not delivering at the stage.
Yeah, they're not, and there's a real threat that Chelsea, if they carry on this way, might actually struggle to qualify for the Champions League.
Agreed.
For a club of Chelsea's pedigree, that's simply not good enough.
No,
Abramovich has invested hundreds of millions for Chelsea to consistently and every season play Champions League football, because that's the way he has built this club, and also that's the only way you can attract the best of talent into London.
And the money.
Yeah, and the money. As well, so he's got to be concerned about that. But there seems to be, I think he's fallen, there's been a falling out with the owner, and it started several weeks ago when he kept emphasizing in every press conference that after all, I don't make the signings at this club.
The transfer policy issues.
Transfer policy issues. He's obviously asked for certain players, and the thing with players like Mourinho, with Conte, Guardiola, they are certain players that they know they can work with. They want those players. And so a certain player, just like people, you know, constantly say, Mourinho let Kevin De Bruyne go. He let Mohamed Salah go. And I know in hindsight, we'll say these players have now turned out to be great players now. But they're not Mourinho-type players.
Yes, that time they were not.
Yeah, they were not. He just doesn't like playing with players of that nature.
Exactly.
So for me, Conte may have asked for certain players who he is not getting at the moment. And he said, the guys that you're bringing in, for example, Bakayoko, are just not good enough.
Yeah. Conte and Mourinho are very much the same. They basically want 25 players in their squad that are model players. Yeah. And they will play to the way they want them to play.
Exactly, yeah.
He's not a Mauricio Pochettino. He's not a Jurgen Klopp or a Pep Guardiola who will use a squad of players, and they want 25 model players in their squad that they can control.
Yeah, and that model, unfortunately, he's got a mold for each of those 25 players, and he's looking for particular players. Now, the guys upstairs don't understand or know that. Mm-hmm. However, they want to control the transfer policy. Why? Because they're thinking of it from a commercial perspective. So they think to themselves, okay, we want to, number one, get players on the cheap. We want to get players who are young, players who possibly we might be able to shift on, but players who are going to do the job for us. Ultimately, we want to win. You put the squad together, you get the results. The results aren't coming because they've lost more games this season, 6 games, than they did the entire 2016-2017 campaign where they lost 5. So that is disaster.
You see, when what they are looking at, they're saying, but you came here, you won the league, you won the league and play in the Champions League. Why are you complaining now? It worked for you the last time. Why isn't it working now? But then at the same time, what you're saying is it's a disaster when you have a team that is detached. The coach is doing his own thing. When he came in, did they sit down and decide and agree, good my friend, this is the policy. This is how we go about our things. Not now Takutango since go media. I'm not the one who did this. I'm not the one who did that. What did he get to be told when he arrived at Chelsea?
Can I ask you a question, Mike? That on the point that Alois raises, which is disconnectedness. Are you seeing that in terms of body language? In terms of, is this a family that's still together working?
We're used to a very lively Conte. We're used to a guy who's very expressive on the touchline. There was a lot of talk last season and earlier this season about Conte and Klopp and their touchline behaviour. Yeah. Over the last 4 weeks, we have not seen that from Conte. He's very quiet.
He's resigned.
Last night, he was almost resigned to his fate. He was very subdued. Just the handshake with the opposing manager at the end. And he
he put his hands in his pockets and he walked off just to say, okay, have a look. This is your team.
Almost
this
defiance. Is the team.
Now, getting back to Alois's point.
Yeah.
I understand what you're saying, Alois, but certain things are difficult to implement, to hold an owner of a club to account when you're now on the job. They could have agreed that, okay, you're in charge of transfer policy, we'll buy the players that you want. But what do you do when Abramovich refused?
We don't know.
I'm giving you as an example and saying, what do you then do as a manager if the owner refuses to get certain players? There's nothing you can do.
There's nothing. You're stuck.
Yeah, you're stuck.
Then we might as well, maybe one day we're going to hear which players did he want.
I know, it's been documented. He wanted Bonucci.
Yep.
He wanted Chiellini. He wanted Arturo Vidal.
Players and you can tell delivered for him before.
Players that he's worked with and have delivered for him before. Because you take a look at key critical positions.
Yep.
You take a look at Bonucci. Would he be playing better than Cahill, David Luiz, or Christensen?
Definitely.
Definitely. Yeah. You take a look at the position Bakayoko is playing. Yeah. Imagine if there was Arturo Vidal, playing in
it's
that position. It's a different proposition.
Arthur.
You replace Diego Costa with Morata.
Yeah.
But you guys said Morata was good enough.
No, he's good enough. But we're saying that there's a difference in quality between Acosta and Morata.
It's a big gap.
Arthur
big
on difference. Our WhatsApp platform has a different take. He says that the behavior of the Chelsea players is disgusting. He reckons that they're about to get another manager sacked. He reckons that this is a player revolt. It doesn't look like that to me. It doesn't look like that
all the time.
It doesn't look like that, to be honest.
See, I think Chelsea fans, they always want to hide behind sabotage. They always think that Chelsea players are sabotaging the coach all the time when they start losing.
Okay.
It doesn't work that way.
The last time they sabotaged the coach, they ended up in 10th, 11th. Yeah. You could tell that this was a season which was disastrous. This season, Chelsea, is it the Champions League places? If that's sabotage, then you're trying to tell us that had they been happy, they would be winning the league title then.
This message, guys, on our WhatsApp platform is very interesting. It says, Conte requested Sandro and Chelsea board gave him Zappa Costa. Conte requested Nainggolan and the Chelsea board gave him Drinkwater. Conte requested Koulibaly, Chelsea board gave him Rudiger. Conte requested Belotti, Chelsea board gave him Morata. Conte requested Virgil van Dijk, Chelsea board gave him nothing. And Conte requested Verratti, Tolisso, Bonucci, Candreva, and you know what happens. Mm. Someone is sleeping on duty at Chelsea. They must not always sack managers. Someone says Conte speaks too much. Does this wash?
Okay, speaks too much. I think every manager, and we have seen it, every manager that has got a problem with their board or with their ownership has only got certain platforms that they can use to highlight the problem. And Conte is using the media to let the fans know that, guys, I am not entirely to blame for the situation.
All managers, the team,
even Rafa Benitez, the situation.
Even
in
Mourinho, remember Mourinho was saying,
as well.
Yeah. It's Edward. I told him to bring in the player. I'm waiting for the player.
It's
that's
a way.
That's all they say. That's all they do.
Benitez is a bit different.
Yeah.
And then there's no money. Chelsea have got money.
Yeah.
No, but it's an ego thing.
What we're saying, Paz, is that they are using the media to highlight what the situation is. And that's what managers will do. So it's not a question of talking too much. It's them trying to put pressure on the owners and the board to actually get some work done. Now, Chelsea, in real danger now of possibly missing out on Champions League football, even though there's a lot of football to be played. You take a look at the Premier League table, Manchester City leading the way, 69 points. Give them the crown and tie the ribbons.
Yeah.
Manchester United in second place, 56 points. Liverpool in third on 51. Chelsea in fourth on 50. Tottenham Hotspurs are just now a point behind Chelsea, and Arsenal are 5 points behind Chelsea on 45 points. So even Arsenal now have got a bit of hope.
They're picking it.
Because there was during Manchester United's troubles in December where Chelsea looked like they were the team that was going to kick on. Finish in second.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, and now
it
has changed.
Yeah, it has changed.
It has changed. They've fallen away. They're in fourth position now. And with Spurs breathing down their neck, 1 point behind
them. Can I tell you something?
And when you look at Arsenal, they can actually fancy their chances as well. They've bought well this transfer window, and they can actually say we can actually have a go at it.
But both those teams, though, I'll tell you what, their next three fixtures I think are going to decide, because you take a look at Chelsea, their next three fixtures, they're at home to West Brom.
Yeah.
You might say, okay, they will win that one. Then they have United away at Old Trafford. Then they're at home to Manchester City. So two tough matches. Arsenal, Spurs away this coming weekend. Manchester City away in their next game. And then they have Brighton. So both those teams, you've got to think the ones that can get more points in these next three fixtures.
Yeah, from those nine.
Yeah. I think we'll be in a good place.
And Chelsea, those Manchester games are sandwiched with Champions League encounters as well. So that could eat. It's going to be a tough game.
Because you take a look at even City as well.
Time for the
City,
for
City
the
has got
well.
Arsenal and Chelsea. Okay, but City can afford to drop points and nothing happened to their lead. United and Liverpool have got games that they will feel that they can win. Manchester United's got Newcastle away, then Chelsea at home, okay, tough game, and then Crystal Palace away. So you fancy
they
United.
They can get six out of that,
they
and
can get six.
Us seven.
Liverpool's got Southampton, West Ham, and Newcastle. So if you take a look at it's between Chelsea and Arsenal to see how are they going to perform in the next three fixtures. If they drop points in those fixtures, they'll be in all sorts of trouble. Let's stay with the Premier League, where with the sales of Premier League broadcasting rights for 2019-22 season, those 3 years just around the corner, it appears a winter break could finally reach England. There are breaks across Europe during the festive season, but English football has yet to join in. The lack of a winter break in the Premier League has been the source of much debate for years, with the national team's lack of success often pinned on the brutal season English clubs go through. It has, however, been revealed that broadcasters have been warned the footballing calendar could be subject to notable changes in the near future. It is the biggest sign yet that wheels are in motion for a winter break in the Premier League. Early plans suggest any winter break will take place after the first weekend of January, when clubs traditionally play third round FA Cup matches. Reports suggest the break would last for a period of 2 weekends. Is this a good idea for you, Paz? Winter break in English football.
Don't be selfish.
No. Why? I don't like it.
Why?
I don't like it because other leagues have all suddenly you go to Europe, they suddenly have a winter break. Why should they start having one in England now?
Because it's affecting the performance of their teams in Europe and of their national team.
Nah, I think it should stay as it is.
Wow, you're a traditionalist, boss.
I am a traditionalist.
Look at this. I'm going to go back to the team we were just discussing, Chelsea. They're having a wretched run of form, okay? They haven't had a break. They're going into a tough run of fixtures, including Champions League fixtures against Barcelona. Look, if they had... Who had a winter break. If they had a bit more freshness about them, who knows? You know, now at this stage, the guys are haggard.
They need to get conditioned to that. I don't want the winter break.
You don't want it?
Yeah, I don't want it.
Why?
What are you going to do? What are you going to do?
Don't be selfish.
Yeah, I'm being selfish. What are we going to do if the English football and the English football...
Watch La Liga. Watch La Liga.
No.
It's two against two. Maybe you can send us messages as well on WhatsApp to let us know whether you are in favour of a winter break in English football. 0731 168 045. That's our WhatsApp number.
Still with the Premiership, Adam Lallana will not receive a first team ban after being sent off for the under-23s last night. Lallana reacted angrily after an aerial clash with 19-year-old Spurs midfielder George Marsh and was shown a straight red card for grabbing Marsh around the neck before being dragged away by teammate Danny Ings. It is understood that any punishment Lallana receives will be confined to the competition in which he was dismissed, so he will not face any suspension for Liverpool's senior team.
Yeah, I saw the video there. I think an over-the-top reaction from Lallana. Yeah. Definitely. Though the youngster, though, overzealous as well. Okay. I don't think there was any reason for him to be leaping up in the air and making that challenge. The ball was clearly gone. And when a player, I think, is returning from injury, there's a lot of frustration as well that goes into it. And he's thinking, hang on, I could just get injured from something that's so innocuous as this. Why are you doing it? And I think that was the main thing. But he overreacted. Listen, you're playing with lighties. You're playing with youngsters, 19 years old.
Wasn't that part of it as well? That he was looking at it and thinking, you lighty, you know, I've got more times than you.
No,
you know.
Obviously, that's what allowed him to be as aggressive. Yeah. Because if it was a bigger player, he wouldn't do that. But for me, over the top. Yeah. He had no right to do that. And I think he must be reminded of his responsibilities as a first team player. Not just that, as an England international whom these youngsters look up to as well.
Yeah, exactly. All right, well, let's move on to international football. Now, a FIFA delegation led by Secretary General Fatma Samoura met with Spanish officials to discuss concerns about government meddling in the local football federation. FIFA sent a letter last year reminding Spanish football officials...
It's 60 years too late in Spain.
...that all member federations must manage their affairs independently. independently and without interference from third parties. The warning reportedly came because of the government's push to hold elections following the arrest of Federation President Angel Maria Vila, on suspicion of corruption. Officials did not immediately release detailed information about what was discussed. FIFA has said it wanted to travel to Madrid to, quote, observe and analyze the situation of the local federation. FIFA once again saying, touch not our anointed, and that is our football federations. But in Spain, it's a little bit tough because, like Mike said, it's been happening for a long time.
You know, the government has been heavily involved in football in Spain, and you know how much football contributes to the
Real
Spanish
Madrid,
economy.
Yes.
you know what I mean. But then I've got a problem with FIFA when criminals from football are being arrested. It's corrupt.
They jump in, exactly.
It's criminal act. They must be arrested. You know, that's the problem even closer to home. Here, when was the last time you heard a football official was arrested for stealing money from football? When?
No, yeah,
they keep on stealing the money. They keep on being corrupt because they know they don't get arrested. And what do? They've got FIFA to protect. No, man, it should stop. If it's about government saying that this chairman must stop this one, yes, I understand. But if it's a criminal activity, guys must be arrested.
Heads must roll. Certainly agree with you there, Bunge. And let's go to Italy. Serie A former Internazionale president Massimo Moratti says he, like many of the club's fans, feel like he has been fooled by the Nerazzurri's form this season. Inter were leading Serie A earlier this campaign and went the first 16 games without losing. However, they failed to win any of their past 8 league fixtures, losing 2 and drawing 6 to slip 15 points behind leaders Napoli. They're now just a point ahead of 5th place Roma and risk missing out on a place in next season's Champions League, which Moratti felt was almost in the bag.
To the Bundesliga, where Borussia Dortmund CEO Hans-Joachim Wandis has threatened to clean out the current squad at the end of the season unless results improve. Belgium striker Michy Batshuayi is on loan from Chelsea. He scored twice on his debut last Friday when Dortmund won 3-2 at Bundesliga bottom side de Cologne to finish the weekend fourth in Germany's top flight. However, André Schürrle's late winner for Dortmund did not disguise another poor team performance after drawing their 3 previous games. Dortmund are 19 points behind runaway German league leaders Bayern Munich, and Watzke says there could be a fire sale at the end of the season.
Yeah, disappointing season for Borussia Dortmund. They remain unbeaten in the league under their new coach, but they haven't been playing convincing football. And of course, they are Germany's biggest club by fan base, and there's a hope that they can challenge, because I think the German football, when it comes to the rivalry they want is Bayern Munich and Borussia Dortmund. When those two teams are healthy, fit and firing, the Bundesliga is exciting.
Yeah, they always want that that kind of rivalry, because that is the rivalry that actually generates interest in German football. They might want Schalke versus Borussia Dortmund. Yes, it's like a domestic, it's traditional. But what they want is Bayern and Borussia Dortmund. Those two must always be firing on all cylinders.
Okay, your DFB Pokal matches are tonight. Paderborn will take on Bayern Munich, and Bayer Leverkusen takes on Werder Bremen.
We're done for today. We're out of time. We'll catch you tomorrow for Wacky Wednesday. May God richly bless you. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Manandi, out.
Be sure to catch ZFM Sport every weekday on ZFM Stereo. My station, your station.